Okay, we're going to do samadhi, which is concentration meditation. And I will start off by explaining why samadhi. What is so important about learning how to meditate? First, just a simple show of hand. How many of you know meditation? Know how to meditate, huh? Know how to, simple one. Now we progressively, you know, get a bit more cheap. Today I can take my time because today, not so many slides. So we will cover the ground nicely and I will leave some room for questions. How many of you, having known meditation, would do it every day? For 1 hour? Half an hour? 10 minutes. 10 minutes better than nothing. Well, he did 10 minutes, did you? You see? It is important and it should be done on a daily basis. And the reason why a lot of us are not doing it is really because you have not truly enjoyed the fruits of meditation. You haven't really tasted what the meditation does to the mind. And as a result, you may not then realize that this meditation, it's a lot more fun than watching television. Okay. About your favorite show, huh? Okay, now, why do we meditate? We meditate because our mind typically is a very noisy marketplace. Our mind makes a lot of noise. There's a lot of mental activities that pops up very fast, very flitting. It seizes the mind for the moment, then disappear. And they're all very fast. The ones that you do remember, already enough for you to say very fast. What about the ones that you don't remember? And they come flooding at you. So when you do meditation, you actually learn to reduce the volume of materials that keep arising in the mind. Thoughts arising, feelings arising, perception arising, thought construction arising. You reduce the volume of traffic jam crowding into the mind. You slow down, specifically slow down thought formation. If you're doing meditation correctly, you will find yourself not thinking so mindlessly, so frequently. Non-stop conversation going on, monologue by yourself. In fact, not even monologue, it's a conversation by yourself. It's going on and on and on, okay? The third thing that meditation does for you is you develop a sharpness in being able to spot, over here I didn't write spot, to spot, see, track, observe mental processes as the mind interacts and reacts to external objects. What do I mean? You hear a sound. At any one time, your five sense organ that deals with the world, at any one time they're all working, right? At any one time they're all working. Your eyes functioning normally, your ears registering sound, your nose can smell well. It doesn't go to sleep, it doesn't shut off. Your tongue, if you put something there, it will taste. And your skin continue to have sensations, right? At any one time. But yet, all you remember is one thing at a time. You see sight, you hear sound, you will experience this, that. It was one at a time. when you start to sharpen your ability to spot, you can actually see arising. Which organ has an interaction with the object, your mind spotted. You will hear the arising of sound consciousness. You will know the arising of a smell consciousness. It will not be a case where after don't know how many seconds, do you all smell something, huh? It would be, what's that? Straight away. And no one else has smelled it. You caught it really, because you're so alert. And you catching. You see yourself so alert, you catch yourself spotting something, being aware of something. After you see it, you've got to follow it. You have to track it. Arising, falling away, arising, falling away. And what does it mean when the mind interacts and reacts to the external world? You see, how do you know you're smelling? Because there is an object out here that presents smell. You caught it, you smell it. If the object has no smell, then you are not aware of it. Are you aware of your neighbor? No, you're not, because your neighbor doesn't smell. If your neighbor smell, then bopian ah. Bad example. Next. Okay. And above all, and this is what is necessary, is that when you are observing the interaction between your sense organ and the sense object, you are very objective. Very objective, looking at that contact. Back to smell. Smell affects people, I don't know why, a lot. Actually, I know why. Smell affects people a lot because for the longest time, this is built into your brain, for the longest time, your only way of knowing that something is deadly and can kill is if it smells. So your ancestors, our early men, they have all learned to avoid food that smell. They all learn to avoid the corpse because it smells. And we know that corpse food, when they start to smell, they can carry a lot of diseases because that kills. So built into your brain is an instinct to avoid danger. And when something smells, it's dangerous. Now, in this time and age, there are things that smell and they're not dangerous. So you can use those. Yes, durian. Cheese. Okay. No, the point is that when you have that contact, if you learn samadhi, you learn to observe your reaction to a contact. Okay? Now, in samadhi, concentration, there are three types of concentration. We have to talk about all three. But I know for many people, they tend to focus on just two of them. They tend to focus on sati, mindfulness, and samadhi, concentration. Okay? So earlier on I asked, do you meditate? First the question was, can you meditate? And the second question was, do you meditate? A lot of you know how to meditate. And then some of you say you do meditate daily. And the odds are you are referring to samadhi meditation, right? The samadhi, the concentration meditation. What's the difference? And when you are new to the practice, you have to know very clear, be very clear in your mind, the difference. Sati is when your attention is put on an object, you focus on the object, you observe the object, you track the object, you follow it. So in the mindfulness meditation, in the sati meditation, you move. The mind flows, it moves. It doesn't lose track of it, it flows, it follows it. So for instance, breath. If you're doing sati, deep using the breath. The breath, later on I'll show you how it's done. You follow the breath. In, out. You follow it in, you follow it out. You know when it's going in, what it's going in, how it's going in. When it comes out, you know when it's coming out, what's coming out, how it's coming out. You know whether it's a long breath, a short breath, and so on and so forth. You track it. You make observation, objective observation. I mentioned to another group that think of sati like a private investigator, a PI. You know, private investigators, they don't just investigate illicit affair. They also investigate crime, I suspect someone's stealing in my company. Can you go track that fella? Check and see whether he's stealing. Now, if you are a PI and you are to follow your suspect, your job is to collect data, objective data about your suspect. If he met with somebody, you want to jot down what time, who he met with, how long they interacted, did you observe that they had exchanges? Very factual. Your job is not to create story. They met in a dark corner, spent 3 hours there, don't know do what. All this you add one, you add. Tell a story somehow, It was a very dark corner, no one's present, I know they're doing something. You added all those things, these little bits in. So sati helps the mind develop objectivity. This is very important to remember. The purpose of sati is to help your mind develop objectivity, meaning to say when you see something, you just look at it, describe it as it is, in a simple adjective, who asks you to use big words? Simple adjective, red shirt is a red shirt. Don't come in with roosh. Really? Roosh? Okay, never mind. So the point is not to be creative, objective, okay? And to put a distance. Sometimes you get very caught up in something and you bury yourself in that something. In sati, you need to preserve a certain distance between you and the object. And then you just observe it objectively. What is samadhi? Samadhi, I call it locking. Your concentration is locked on one object. And don't migrate point to point. Just lock on one object, keep it there, keep it still and try to stay with it for as long as you can. Just lock it, okay? Earlier on, I said the breath. If it's sati, you follow the breath, in, out. If it's samadhi, you just watch the breath at one spot. Don't go around the world, just stay there, one spot. Okay? Now, for people who are interested in developing sati, I will always encourage them to look at Satipatthana Sutta. There are two versions. The longer version is found in the Digha Nikaya, the long saying. The slightly shorter version is found in the Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length saying. Okay? They are identical except for one small section. Now, the point that I want you to note is, this is what the Buddha said. Then the Blessed One addressed the bhikkhus as follows. This is the only way, ekayano mago, for the purification of beings. Ekayago, eka, one. Only one. Mago, way, path. For the purification of beings, for the overcoming of sorrow and lamentation, for the destruction of suffering and grief. Suffering, grief, okay? For reaching the right path, for the attainment of Nibbana. namely the four foundations of mindfulness. So, Buddha had said that if you want to understand the Dhamma, it is necessary that you first also develop skill in watching the mind. And in watching the mind, the Buddha gave, he went on to explain how it's to be done, okay? How do you watch the mind? Buddha gave four objects, hence the four foundations of mindfulness, four types of object. All of them to do with the mind, all of them. One of them is using the body as a foundation for you to understand the mind. The other three directly the mind, okay? This is the first one. The first foundation of mindfulness, using the physical form, the body, activities of the body, and you're using those activities to try and understand your mind. A bhikkhu lives contemplating the body in the body, the former, in this form, in this physical form. You are clear, you're sharp, you're energized, ardent, clearly comprehending, sampajano, mindful, having overcome in this world covetousness and grief. Let me just explain this portion first. You see what it says here? There is a certain clarity. In order to do this meditation well, there is a certain clarity your mind must achieve. Clearly comprehending, you know exactly what you are looking at. You don't let it go. You stay with it. And you must also let go of the instincts in your mind. We have very strong negativity instincts. And here in this sutta, the Buddha reminds us that you need to be able to let go of your wanting. And when you have a lot of wanting, you will have a lot of dissatisfaction. Those instincts, okay? So, in order that you can do it, you have to be able to develop certain instincts within the mind. Okay, never mind, we'll go on first. So, contemplating the body, the form, the physical form, contemplating feelings, strict feelings, okay? In the feeling, again, the same expression, ardent, clearly comprehending, knowing what you're doing, very clear in your mind, being very mindful, very attentive, and having overcome covetousness and grief. Now you tell me, a lot of us, when we do sati, we say we do sati meditation. Do we do this? You say we do, we happily proclaim we do sati meditation, right? When you step out to do your sati meditation and you watch your feelings or you watch your form, your body, did you really do all these things? Did you prepare your mind for it? Mind is sharp, energized, clear, going to see exactly what's happening, and the mind has let go of craving, wanting. Bola. Most time you see lah. You just chong into it. You actually never do all this preparatory work, right? Then you ask, how come Buddha one doesn't work one? We didn't do it correctly lah. Doesn't matter. Now that you're reading the suttas, we are beginning to have an understanding that you must do certain things. Okay. So watching the body, watching feelings. The next one is watching consciousness, a state of mind. Watching mind. Same thing. Being very clear, very energized, full of passion, ardent, fully understanding it, being clear and so on, and having let go, always let go, being aware of the mind. And the last one, the word mental object was actually translated by Bhikkhu Bodhi Bante. In Pali, the word used was Dhamma. And what I personally think is that it's not just simple mental objects, but it's a specific series of them that Buddha had identified as states of mind, experiences you need to be aware of. All this will be elaborated, okay? This is just the first part. Now we take just one. We take breath. This is a practitioner series, right? So I have to walk you through the actual method of doing things, right? And then if you want to sleep, try not to snore. Huh? But we can hear you. Okay. Samasati. Listen to the words. This whole thing here, how to do it right, specific to the breath. Okay? A monk, he is teaching it to a monk. Look at this. Gone to a forest, sit at the foot of a tree or an empty room. The point is, where you are actually does matter. If you are new to this, you're practicing it, it helps if you find an environment which is quiet. Okay? And he recommends that you sit cross-legged, but the point is to keep the body upright. Even if you find you can't sit cross-legged because there's some structural issues with the legs, doesn't matter. You can sit on a chair, but upright. Okay, how do you sit on a chair and be upright? Don't slouch lah. Just sit up. You see so many of you sitting upright, what? Yeah, that's fine. The ones who are not sitting upright, never mind, let them sleep. Keep the body up, okay? The reason why this has been translated like this, fixes his awareness in the area around the mouth, is because of the Pali word. Now, I have read another translation and I think that one is more correct. It is not so much that you are fixing an awareness around mouth, but it is fixing an awareness here, in the present, here and now. Okay? As opposed to a physical location, it is a mental location. The mind is aware I'm putting my attention here. Okay? When the mind is aware of putting its attention here, you become aware of the breath. You become aware of the breath. With that awareness, when you breathe in, you need to be able, you see the word understands properly. I'm breathing in a deep breath. Breathing out, I'm breathing out a deep breath. When you're breathing in a shallow breath, you're aware, you understand properly, which means to say, you pay very close attention to the nature of the breath that's going in and out. You flow with it, you follow it, your mind, full attention. You are very clear and you know that there is a breath. When it goes in, you know and you understand that it is going in. You're very aware of the entire process. And if it comes out, the same thing, the same direction. You must watch it as it goes in. You say, oh, go in, come out. You follow it. Alert, clear. Your mind, lots of mental energy. Because if you don't have mental energy, you will fall asleep. Yes, all those sheepish faces. Who asked you don't put mental energy? Be very energized and follow. Okay, just do it. Actually, it works. You know? If you do it exactly as the Buddha said here, you don't fall asleep. It's when you don't do it exactly as he said it, you will fall asleep. That's my personal experience, okay? It's not finished yet, okay? So, objective description, short breath, shallow breath, deep breath, long breath. Not very colorful words, yes? Simple words, words that your primary two kids will know. Primary one, make it primary one. These days the kids are very smart. Not long, tedious, extended breath. Who knows extended? Only you know. No need all these tedious, long words. Simple one. Look at that. As you are, when the breath goes in, when it comes back, comes out, you follow this, feeling the whole body, I shall breathe in. In your meditation, as you sit, you are aware of your form. You are aware of the form. No need to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 go around feeling the body. You just need to know, be aware of this form, okay? Be aware of the breath, be aware of the form, be aware of the bodily activities coming down. And you need to, if your mind starts to observe these phenomena, it stays alert. What you want is the mind to stay alert. So the mind, seeing the breath, in and out, follow it. Occasionally you feel your form, being aware of form sitting, being aware of your physical activities coming down, and continuing to go back to your breath, you will find yourself remaining alert. It's when all you are doing is the breath and nothing else, and you're not moving the mind to be aware of the environment, the physical environment, you can drift. How many of you would say that when you meditate, you have never fallen asleep? All have? All of you have? How many of you would say that when you meditate, you occasionally don't fall asleep? You mean 10-10 one? 10 times sit, 10 times sleep. You don't sleep enough at night. And the time when you don't sleep, how did you do it? How long did you sit? You said so short, you didn't have time to sleep. This is important because it is your own mental rhythm and your own mental skill and your own physical energy. So you need to be aware of, because if you sleep, you're not learning things. You're not seeing things. And no matter how long you sit, if two-thirds wanted, two-thirds sleeping, one-third managed to wake up, then it's not going to be very useful, you see. You need a sustained period of being so sharp that you sit there quietly just watching the mind. Sustained period, okay? So the word dwell, you watch this word now, is being, you are, dwelling implies a sustained state of being, So you dwell a sustained state, being very mindful, you keep observing the form, the body, and you observe, look at this word, phenomenal of arising in the body. observing the phenomenon of passing away in the body. And observe the phenomenon, this means the, you know, you rise, hang around, fall, there is an arising. It doesn't rise, dot. It arises, it's kind of linger around, and then it falls away. Okay? If your mind is able to look at the breath, observe that form, after a while, the mind comes down, and it comes down enough, it will start to be able to see the arising of phenomenon. What is this phenomenon? Some of you are already looking so distraught, you haven't sat. When you sit and you watch your breath is a phenomenon. When you sit and you feel air going through your system, air is then for you the phenomenon, a physical phenomenon. Indigestion is a phenomenon. Pain arising from a certain cramped position is a phenomenon. In other words, whatever catches your attention when you are sitting. What have you been doing? Sleeping. When you sit and you watch the mind, when you sit and you watch the form, surely there's a lot of activities going on, right? Then some will say, oh, my mind gets very quiet very fast. Okay, we'll talk about mind afterwards. Huh? So when you look at these physical phenomena, when you watch this physical phenomena, see how they arise, hang around, and dissipate. Ultimately, it's about seeing how the physical phenomenon arises and dissipate. You can see this, awareness is established. Your awareness is there, you say, this is body, this is the form. But you don't want to get too caught up in the body. You don't want to watch it like you use a magnifying glass and look at the end crawl. You don't want to watch it to that level. You want to establish sharp awareness, sharp mindfulness. And then after that awareness and is sharp enough, you need to be able to pull back a little. And then all you are seeing is, look at this word. Thus, he develops awareness to such an extent that there is mere understanding along with mere awareness. Two things happening. Sharpness of concentration, sharpness of mindfulness, being able to follow the phenomenon. And then you need to be able to pull back and say there is a rhythm up and down, flow arising, falling away, the flow, there's a rhythm. And you are aware of that life's rhythm. It's said here, you develop your awareness to such an extent that there is mere understanding and along with mere awareness. So on the one hand, you have to track it. When you first start off, you've got to follow it closely, be sharp to recognize it, be sharp to be able to call it, give it adjectives. And then when your mindfulness is established, you must pull back and start to see a pattern, a flow. Rising, falling away. Rising, falling away. It's a pattern. And you have to then observe this pattern, this flow of rising and falling away. Do you understand this? No. Okay. Why not? Okay, this is just a sutta. You see, when you sit to meditate, right, you can end up doing the following things. Okay, now we put the suttas aside. You can end up, when you sit for your sati, mindfulness meditation, many of you have gone for mindfulness practice, right? Muka kong. What is this? Correct lah, right? A lot of you have gone for mindfulness practice. So when you go for mindfulness practice, what do they tell you to do? Oh, that's so helpful. watch. Dare you to watch, right? So when you eat, you do slow motion. Yes? When you drink, you also do slow motion, right? You flow. When you walk, you take like half an hour to get from the camera to the door. Yeah? Because you're supposed to do slow motion, right? Step. Rising, rising, pushing, pushing, putting down, ah, yeah, too fast, reverse. Start again. Rising, rising, pushing, pushing, right? That's what you do, right? And then after you have done this, you feel very stupid, but never mind. Continue doing it because this is supposed to be the way to do it, right? You do this. But if you look at what is said here, it is not said like that. In fact, I'll show you the rest. While going forward or backward, he does so with constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. When you're looking straight or looking sideways, he does so with constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. While he's bending, stretching, wearing his robe, carrying his bowl, eating, drinking, chewing, savoring, does so with the constant, thorough understanding of awareness. While attending to the calls of nature, that's not the bird call, he does so with constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. Walking, standing, sleeping, sitting, sleeping, everything does so with the constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. What's the one word that keep appearing? No, constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. You are so spontaneous, I can't believe it. This is the word of phrase, my mistake. What's the one phrase that keep appearing? Constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. Okay, now I reverse, okay, previous screen. Let me explain again. Earlier on, we talked about standing, the walking part, and I kept making a little joke out of it. Do you see what's wrong with it? You had no constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. But to get to a point where your mind can see and understand, to see, to recognize, to understand, the sati, the awareness, has to be very strong. Get it? So you push it further back. At the start point when you sit, you need to know how to develop it until it is very strong. It's very clear. The mind is very aware. It is watching clearly and sharply, and it can see, it can understand. It must see and understand. And to do that, you use, if you start off using the breath, lock onto the breath, follow it in, follow it out, being able, constantly, being able to say long, short, deep, shallow, in, out, whatever. One adjective. This is to get your mind alert. Alert. Get your mind focused. Energized mind, focused mind must be able to. Why do you need those adjectives? It must know what's going on. If you don't give it an adjective, your mind will just go still and not know what's going on. It's just, it's like a mirror already. You don't want that. You want the mind to be able to, Yeah, but the mind must be able to do that. It's like that, it's like that, it's like that. It must be able, but it cannot talk. So, on the one hand, it is able to say, I can identify this, this is perception. I can identify this. I see this. Seeing. But on the other, it cannot talk. I see, so many things to see. It's talking too much. Real the sang ku liu po already, we don't want that. That's not the correct mind. So observe. What's the difference? Look, I see the confusion in your faces. What is the difference between a mind that see and observe and a mind that talks a lot? I'm going to use an example which I used at another place this morning. Because somehow this kind of example people remember. You are private investigator, right? You're supposed to catch illicit affair now, okay? Someone came out of the building, the one you're trailing, the guy you are suspecting. Came out of the building, he hopped into his car, a female head pops out the window from say third floor, wave goodbye, he drove off. If you are observing objectively without comments, what would you write? Exit, what time? Got into the car, what time? Head, observe to be female. Stick out of window, what time? How long she was there? Three waves. Head went in, he started car, move off, what time? It's very objective, okay? Talkative, the sangku niu po type one. He came out at this time, wow, he looks all disheveled. Don't know what he was doing inside there already, man. Whole night like that, you are not there the whole night. Whole night like that, sure got things going on. You walk funny also, walk funny. Got into car, took so long. Then the girl came out and waved goodbye and kisses and all. Then he waved and he had a lot of things to say to her, which you didn't observe. You just thought they should have a conversation. So you added in the conversation part. You see what I'm saying? That's talking too much. And in this method, you train your mind not to talk so much. You got so many things to say, you might as well write 武侠小说. 琼瑶, whatever. That one, a lot more things to say. But if you are a Buddhist practitioner of sati, satya, cannot talk so much. One word only. So I'll give you another example. You're sitting on the floor. Describe.
Bum on the floor.
Very good. And? Hard.
Quite soft.
Okay. Quite soft. That's good. Anything else? Where's your contact point? Okay, so if you are observant, you will be observing where there is pressure, where there is no pressure. And if there is pressure, you observe if there is pain, no pain. And then if let's say there is the arising of discomfort, you know, arising. That's all, arising, discomfort, arising. You wouldn't say, I feel discomfort, oh, die, my leg gone already. Sure drop off one after this lecture. Because I can see, the blood not flowing anymore. I need a doctor on the house, amputate the leg. Otherwise gangrene sets in and hits my brain. Tonight I'll be dead. Can you see how much you've spoken already? Okay, so objective, minimal, say what is there, nothing more. Nothing more. Don't speculate. Don't thought construct, don't hypothesize, don't paint scenario, it's not your job. Just be aware of objective data points. That's all. And when you keep looking at data point, when you keep looking, that's not the end goal. The end goal is, as you keep looking at all these data points, your awareness is sharpened. And when it is sharpened, it then starts to make connection. Connection. And what does it mean by making connection? It will see the pain goes up. I can see my feelings resenting it. I can then see a rising of dukkha. That's how you spot dukkha. Contact, arising, contact, desire, dukkha. But the pain, when it comes, goes up and down, up and down, up and down. Observe it. Can you see that pattern? If you can see the pattern, this is when you have constant, thorough understanding of change. And you need to, in your daily life, see this. Look, these guys are not meditating anymore. No? He's bending, stretching, he's wearing his baju. He's eating, he's chewing, he's doing all kinds of things. He's answering the call of nature. Yeah, and therefore, in your daily life, if your mindfulness is sharp enough, you just observe the pattern, the flow. So will you therefore go slow motion in your life? No lah. How? Bus come already, raise hand. Mindfully wave hand. The bus driver won't stop. He may scared, he just move on. Okay? And then if you're driving on the road, someone will call police. Because you're so slow, the guy's running across the road faster than you. The point is, you live a normal life. And once you, in your meditation, once you begin to spot the pattern of change, movement, breath goes in, breath must come out. Right? The breath goes in, the breath comes out, the breath keeps changing. The breath changes. Sometimes you breathe deeper. And then you look at your body, there's air moving around. There's the sensation of change within the body. Sensation of change within the body. Your feelings, your mood, they all start to change. You can see those things. You are supposed to see these things. And when you see these things, you're supposed to say, Eureka! Constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. Got it! Yeah! Then because you got it, right? Then out of meditation, now you're very kilat already, you got it. So now you're out of meditation, when you're eating, yeah, look how things change. You chew, even the sensation in the mouth, the food will start off the, whatever that goes in, it starts off being hard, starts off being large. Then as you chew, because very small, very minute. And if you're watching it very carefully, of course don't chew off your tongue, but you know, as you're watching very closely, you will see that they have changed. So if you are in the state of mindfulness, in the state of clarity, you can actually see change. Last week we talked about jnana dasana. Seeing it, that's seeing it. Jnana is understanding it. Dasana is seeing it. So you chew your food. Tonight, go home, chew slowly. Watch how the food morph from being large and cumbersome to being very small. And you are doing it so well. You chew 35 times, they ask you to, right? Chew 35 times, it became water. Nothing left to chew. See the transformation. Get it? And when you look at these things, what you're supposed to look out for? The pattern. Things change. You have been eating food for what, 21 years? 22 years? And you still haven't noticed that food change. Change is around you. Change is experienced all the time. But we don't get it. So instead, we go for a retreat, and then we morph into mechanical robots. And we still don't get it. We don't know why we're doing it. This is why we're doing it. When you do it slowly, you begin to reduce the amount of thoughts. You begin to be aware of the arising. You begin to see the cessation of each thought. As it comes up, it fades away. You see what I'm saying? Can you see the connection now? The thought comes and the thought goes. The feelings come and the feelings go. You don't see impermanence there? You got to shove it into your face. But if we see it, how is it we don't feel it? Because you haven't experienced it deep enough in your meditation. All you have is conceptually, I see my food being more digestible now. But that is only conceptual, but at least that's seeing. And then if you start to, your mind is of a certain state, it's quiet enough, it's mindful enough, it's, if it's tranquil enough, it can suddenly register that experience as impermanence. You have to register it in a way that your mind says, this is what Buddha said. Okay? So that was form. Walking, chewing, eating, whatever, they are all forms. Physical forms. The physical form, trying to understand, use the physical form to help you understand the mind. From here on, onwards, all mental activities. So the first one says, the second one says, mindfulness on feelings. We all get very caught up in our feelings. Even the nicest person will snap at you when he's in a bad mood. And even the nastier person will smile at you when he's in a good mood. You see how hopeless we are? So easily driven by our feelings. Eh? So many songs, the entire album. You know, you went dig out the world collection of songs, the don't know how many million songs, 99% feelings. 1% some other kind of feelings. Usually it's about love, love. And then there's one on parent love, another one on love for a sibling, probably that was the least. But then the one about the love person, the person you love, oh, so many, everyone, every other one you just change, oh, Malay one and Indian one, same, all about that, right? So feelings, we are very attached to it, we're all very attached. When feelings come up, we can't see. Then you say, no, I can see. Yeah. You are not seeing it the way you're supposed to as a practitioner. You are feeling it. You are being sucked into the whirlpool. You're being twirled around by your feelings. That's not seeing. That's being blinded by feelings. Okay? So, feelings, Buddha said, and this is how he helps you to get a grip on the feelings. You are given only 3 adjectives to use. No need create new ones, only 3. Pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. Unless you want it to be many words, neither unpleasant nor pleasant. But actually means neutral, okay? So when you feel pain, emotional pain or physical pain, someone pao qi ni, oh very painful, unpleasant. You see, the moment you give it one rather clinical word, it straight away insert a distance. You use clinical words so that you put a distance between what you are experiencing and the I. A distance between what you are feeling, you're experiencing, and I. You want that distance. If you don't have this distance, you can't see feeling arising and falling away. The same thing. All these objects are meant for your mind to see arising and falling away so that you have a constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. I will repeat until you go home and this becomes a mantra. Tonight, Om, constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. You get it? So even for feelings, the same. You see unpleasant, you will literally say unpleasant, unpleasant, more unpleasant, more unpleasant, eh? Not so unpleasant. Turning, less unpleasant, 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 and fades away, neutral. And then when it is pleasant, that's the hard one. Unpleasant is easy, because usually unpleasant, we get very fixated. But when it's pleasant, you don't. Eh, who looks at pleasant? Just enjoy. Yeah? When it's pleasant, you just enjoy. A problem lah, supposed to, which is why we get very, very attached to pleasant feelings and we only want to see the unpleasant ones. How to let go like that? You want to contain craving, you must be able to watch pleasant feeling. Did you know that? Watching unpleasant feeling helps you understand the nature of the mind. It's a very powerful teacher. Because if you can track feeling and see it unpleasant, hit a maximum, always recognize the maximum, it will turn down and it will go down and become not so painful, not unpleasant anymore, it becomes neutral. You always follow it through. And this will teach you three things. Supposed to teach you three things, okay? Number one, the fact that it goes up and come down, surely that teaches you impermanence, yes? The fact that, did you really want unpleasantness? You don't, right? You don't want unpleasant feeling, but it came on by itself. It's condition. It's anatta. You had nothing to do with it. You didn't drive it. It came on by itself because of condition. So you must also learn that. What came on by itself? Unpleasant. And then, based on the certain condition, it drives at a certain speed, it will fade away by itself. You want the unpleasantness to go away quickly, quickly, but it doesn't go away quickly, quickly. It goes away on its own pace. It comes, it fades away by itself. For those of you who have done meditation and are quite skilled at sati, you must have seen this in your meditation. The pain, the pain, the pain, the pain, the pain, the pain. Yeah, not so painful anymore. I'm enlightened. Not yet, not yet. Okay? So you see the pain, the pain, and then it fades away. Get it? That's teaching you anicca. It teaches you anatta. You didn't drive it. It fades by itself. Then you say, but I still feel I. Yeah, yeah, it's okay. You can feel I. But you must understand, it is driven by condition. It wasn't driven by your soul. It wasn't driven by your essence. It's driven by condition, its own condition. And the third thing that you should have picked up is dukkha, the nature, the very nature of dukkha. Why is that so? It feels most unpleasant. Have you even looked at why it was unpleasant? And if you look very closely at why a sensation is unpleasant, you will also find that underpinning the sensation is, I don't want this feeling. I don't want. 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 Like a three-year-old kid making a lot of noise. No, three-year-old, you're better behaved. Two-year-old kid making a lot of noise. And it's the I don't want that exacerbates the dukkha. So every time you look at leg pain when you're sitting at meditation, right? When you look at leg pain, please don't stand up, stay there for a while. Just for a while, 2 seconds, just stay there, okay? And you will observe that there are two types of pain when there's a pain going on in your physical form. There is a physical pain, which you had nothing to do with, and there is a mental pain, because you really want to do something about it. And because of the mental pain, it's because of the mental pain that the physical pain feels unbearable. If it's strictly just the physical pain and your mental pain, and there's no mental craving about that pain, I will watch you, lor. You do whatever you want. You do your best. I'll just watch you, lor. If it's like that, then you will actually find that the physical pain can trot its way out and disappear. Okay? It can actually go at its own rhythm and then settles by itself, and that's it. It can. I'm not saying that it will for sure happen, and I cannot guarantee your leg won't drop off. But it should, lah. It should. I mean, it shouldn't drop off. And it should fade away, the pain. I mean, not the leg. Okay. Now that we are talking about unpleasant, then why do I say that to be able to let go of craving, you have to look at pleasant? Most of us, we love pleasant. Right at the early lectures, I've already said that when life is always unpleasant and you're fully aware of it, you will go kill yourself. I step. I cannot die. Step some more. I'll go kill myself. Because we believe that life should be pleasant. Should be pleasant. So are you crazy? We are having pleasantness and you want me to what, look at it? Yeah, because this practice is about getting the mind to see the exact nature of itself. And then, after it has seen the exact nature, it can let go. Must let go. Able to just let be, to drop. And to do that, to let be, it has to see both the positive and the negative. So Buddhist meditation, a lot of us very happy to embrace it because it helped us to manage the negative. And then we leave it to the next guy to handle the positive. Next life, next life. Cannot, you want to do one, must do both. Otherwise the poor guy next life will start with both again. No? So, how do you deal with the positive? In the same way, you see positive, it's a good feeling, pleasant, right? It's pleasant. Pleasant. When you look at pleasant, you observe pleasant arising. So, oh, so pleasant. It will hit a peak. It will turn, quite average really. This pleasantness is quite average. And the pleasant will fade. And it becomes neutral. In the same way, unpleasant arises and fades away. Pleasant also arises and fades away. And then you will say, like that means what? Like that I got no more pleasant. Like that, you have peace. Because if you keep seeing this rising and falling away, rising and falling away, rising and falling away, the mind becomes neutral, doesn't cling, doesn't chase as much. Our mind instinctively will chase after things. Think of it like your mind is a dog. I'm not insulting you. I merely say, think of your mind like a dog, okay? And the dog sits there, and you take a ball, and you throw, and the dog will run after the ball, right? And it's fun! So it kept running after the ball, kept running after the ball, kept running after the ball. Then it got tired. If it sits there and kept watching, it will get tired. Then it doesn't run after the ball anymore. So things happen, you experience, you can still enjoy it, but you have seen it so many times. It's just another ball. You throw a doll, I'll run. I throw a ball, I'm used to it, don't want to run. No need to chase. Same. So after you own your 10th iPad, right, the 11th coming out, not so exciting. If you have never owned a single iPad, the first one that comes out, it's the invention of the century, man. You see what I'm saying? You own your first handphone, the one that is so big, you drop down, someone will sure die one, or crack a car, a huge one. After that, since then, you have owned that, now they're so small. In fact, now you wear on your watch. Yeah? Hello? It's very weird, but never mind, that's what you do now. Are you still enthralled, so caught up with your phone? No lah. It's just something only ma. Not so caught up already. Disappear, never mind. I go to Singtel, buy new one. You see what I'm saying? The point is, when you start looking and looking and looking at feelings, both pleasant and unpleasant, you will learn to recognize its feature and its energy. Pleasant ones have their own energy and their own strength. Unpleasant one also has their own energy and own strength. And both of them, the same thing, they don't last. They will come out, they will hit a plateau, hit a peak, plateau, and dissipate. All same. And you keep looking until you got used to it. You recognized it. Nothing special anymore. Then what happened? Then the mind settles down. The mind is not chasing, it is not shaky. This is what it means when we say the mind then becomes unshakable. You are no longer shaking in response to external object which drives your feelings. No more. Used to it really. Okay? The next one talks about phenomenal. The phenomenal of sensations. Same thing. Sorry, not this one. Next one. Citta, the mind. Being mindful of the state of mind not the content and the details of mind, a state. Example, how many of you would describe yourself as a relatively generous person? No need to be shy. Surely you don't want me to think of you as really stingy. Generous, generally we're quite generous, right? You have given before, right? BF needs contribution. Okay, when you were giving, when you were making your offering, did you see your mind? Did you notice the mind? No. Okay, after this, go and contribute. Watch the heart opens up. I need you to see this giving heart, because in a giving heart, the mind opens. Okay, okay, anger, anger. Surely you got anger one. Huh? Who got no anger? 站出来. 没有. Okay, can use this example. You all got anger. You know what it feels, right? Eh? When you are angry, did you look at your mind? Also never see. When you look at your mind in an angry state, did you see that it's tight? That it's small? That it's hard? Next time, go see. Okay? When your temper comes out, your mind is hard. It's like a pebble. Because it's small, ma, petty. Pebble. Not like a rock. Okay? It's a pebble. So small-minded you are. When your mind is happy, it's like the cloud. Not crowd. Cloud. Wide. Giving. Wide. Span and white also lah. So nice and soft and those are state. Their mind, their state of mind. And that's what we're talking about. Expanded, scattered. Watch your mind when it is concentrated. Tonight, meditate, okay? Tonight, go home, you're all inspired to sit for 1 hour or more. Indian time. It's flexible, okay? India time, okay? You say what? India time, flexible, okay? So we will do, or Chinese wedding time, lagi more flexible. The point is, we should sit, watch the concentration, and then see the mind when it becomes concentrated. How does it look like? How does it feel like? And you need to be aware of that. This one is not easy. It gets harder and harder. Why did Buddha start with physical form? It's the most gross. A very good friend who is a fellow meditator used to say, it's the most gross. You can't miss it. How in the way you miss your hand? Seriously. Then you go and beat. Ayoh, so painful. How are you going to miss that? Of course, if the hand dropped off, you'll miss it. But if the hand is hurting, you won't miss it, right? And then it gets easier. Sorry, it gets harder. Feelings. Feelings are very difficult to watch because you get very caught up. You can stay relatively detached to breath. It's very difficult to be detached to feelings. You bring it into the mind and you try to look at the state of mind and it gets harder. I asked you right now, you all have a mind, right? They are with you, right? Now describe your state of mind. What's it like? Attentive. Good. A student. Anyone else? Huh?
Disturbed by the noise.
Okay. Disturbed mind, what does it look like? Shaking, unsettled, energy, a bit restless, yes? Are there? All pass ready. All those of you who are disturbed by the noise downstairs afterwards, after class, go to thank them, okay? Because it's because of their wonderful music that you are seeing a mind that is scattered. Restless, bouncing around. And that's the nature of the mind now. Okay? The last one is my favorite. The last one, mindfulness of Dhamma. Again, translated as mental content. I look at all the words used here, and they all have to do with the practice. The practice. And therefore, if you are a very sincere practitioner, you should also memorize these words here. Nivaranas. I kept using this word today. Nivaranas, translated as hindrances. Hindrances. Hindrances, there are five sets. For hindrances, there are five sets. Know the five types of hindrances. Any of these five, if they exist within you in large quantity, in a sizable amount, very difficult for you to meditate. It can be, I must say this, it can be a momentary thing. Occasionally, given condition, these hindrances arise, or it can be almost a natural state of mind for you because you have been angry for so long, because you have been greedy for so long, because you have been confused for so long, etc., etc. When you have had a certain experience of the Nivaranas for a long, long time, it almost becomes your instinct. Then when you try to sit, those kind of energy is a obstacle for the practice. Okay? So there are five kinds. Chaga. Think of it this way. Actually, chaga is wrong. It should be kama chanda. Kama chanda, sense desire. Sense desire, okay? A monk, whenever sense desire is present, he must understand that properly. He must understand that there is sense desire in me. He understands properly how sense desire that has not a reason comes to arise. He understands properly how sense desire that are already there gets eradicated. He understands properly how sense desire that has now been eradicated will no longer arise. So you're now an arahant. Okay? Let me explain this slowly. The first Nivarana is a desire associated with your sense organs. So if you are somebody who will describe yourself as a connoisseur of food, you're a gourmet, no less. All this French word, very scary one. The gourmet, okay? If you will describe yourself as an audiophile, you see all French, audiophile, you like music. The sound a little bit of also cannot change the equipment. Okay? If you are the sort who, when you watch shows, HD not good enough. SD, super high. Okay, never mind, he's going to explain why. The super duper resolution type, only that is good enough. Where you can see the fellas, not just pimple, but blackheads. Okay? When you sleep, it has to be 400 thread cotton. Make it pure silk, why not? Huh? Okay, if you are like that, you have this in huge quantity. Because you have a need to delight in sense organ, sense pleasure. You need that. You must have that. You buy the chiocheng, it has to be special brand. Chiocheng means what? Soya sauce, yeah. Soya sauce, huh? It has to be this special brand, mixed in a certain way, and so on and so forth, and so on and so forth, okay? So if you have this kind of what we call discriminatory taste, then it presents a problem. This one is your problem. This particular sense desire is your problem. Okay, not the wailing, but the sense desire. Okay? And you need to, in the practice, you have to be aware when it's there and when it's not there. Can you see that? When it is there, you know. When it is not there, you'll know. Sense desire is absent. must know. Why? Why? No, not even there, why must know? Know why it's not there. Be aware that it's not there. Be aware why it's not there. Why do you need to know why it's not there? Because if you want to know how to let it go, you've got to know what caused the sense desire not to be there. What's that condition? Learn to understand the condition that gave rise to it. Learn to know when the conditions are not there. This particular affliction is not there. And know how to let it go. You see, gets eradicated. And then when it's no longer there, you must also know it won't come up again. Okay? Know it's not there. Know when it's there. That's an easy one. Know when it's not even there. That's a slightly difficult one. Know why it didn't come up. Know how, when it's up, how to get rid of it. And know when it no longer arises. Because if it no longer arises, you are an anagami. Sense delight. If it doesn't arise in you anymore, congratulations. You got your anagami passport. Okay? Oh, we forgot to break. We had so much fun, we forgot to break. Okay, okay. Now we break. I will just finish. Wait, let me just say, I will give you the nivaranas first. The nivaranas are 5 sets, okay? Sense desire is one. Ill will is the second one. Ill will. The third one is very slow, heavy energy. So that's why it has been said to be slow, sloth, torpor, heavy. Okay? Heavy. The fourth one is very excitable, very, very hurried energy. Can't settle. The energy spins very fast. So worry or restlessness. It parks in the same category. And the last one is perplexity. A mind that goes, what? Why? Don't understand. What do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean? Ah, that one. That awful mind. Don't understand. Which one is right? You know, when Buddha was on his deathbed, there was a student that came to see him, wandering ascetic who came to visit him. And this wandering ascetic basically said to the Buddha, you know, this school says this and that school says that, and really who's right and who's wrong? That is a state of perplexity. And for a seeker, many of you are here because you want to know a little bit more about Dhamma, but some of you are more than that. You really want to know Dhamma. It pains you not to know Dhamma. You may have this particular state of mind, this perplexity, this thing that goes, what is it? Dhamma. It's supposed to be something you can see, but I can't see. Yeah. Go for a retreat. Ah, dukkha arya satya, come out. I still can't see. That is perplexity. Okay, that's a particular state of mind. All these 5, if they come up, they're a big problem for a practitioner. The other mindfulness of the Dhamma, the other ones would be your 4 Noble Truths, being aware of the 4 Noble Truths, being aware of anicca, dukkha, anatta, being aware of Eightfold Path and so on and so forth. So you see, all these are the 7 factors of enlightenment. All these are Dhamma concepts. They are Dhamma concepts. Being aware that they are there or being aware that they are not there gives you a clue as to your practice, your state of practice. If you're aware that all the nivaranas are not there, your mind is very mindful, it is extremely energetic, you're constantly looking at Dhamma, you can feel peace, joy, comfort in your heart and your mind is focused, and yet at the same time you're somewhat detached, you're on the verge of entering the stream. No nivaranas, 7 factors all there, you are about to hit jackpot. Okay? What is right concentration? I need you to pay attention, very close attention to the exact wording here. Buddha doesn't add and subtract one. He is very precise. All the words he put up there tell the story. If you take away even one word, the story is a little diluted. Okay? A monk, watch, the first thing, you have to be detached from craving. You see that? Even before you sit to watch your breath, you have to be detached from craving. You have to be detached from the unwholesome mental states. The unwholesome mental states, there are two kinds. One type is your lobha, dosa, moha. Lobha, greed, dosa, anger, moha, ignorance, for want of a better word, okay? A delusion, ignorance. The other set was what I said earlier, nivaranas, the hindrances. The hindrances goes back to your sense desires, your anger, restless energy, the very slow energy or overly excitable energy or perplexity. Okay? Both sets cannot be there. Any element of these two sets being there will make it very difficult to concentrate. So if you are the sort who gets angry very easily, or if you look within you, you find yourself very restless, very restless. Mind talks a lot, think a lot. Then you will find that when you sit, it's actually very difficult for the mind to focus on one object and stay there. Very difficult. It kept drifting all over the place. So, repeat, You must be detached from the craving, detached from the unwholesome mental states. You enter into the first absorption, which is born of detachment. Born of detachment. Because there is no attachment, nothing, the mind can then focus. How do you know when the mind is focused enough? You will have vitakka, vichara. Translated by Bhante Bhikkhu Bodhi as initial and sustained application, vitakka actually is like thinking. The mind can think. Vichara is a mind that kind of, the thought can flow. It actually has thinking here. I like to look at it as you are trying to lock your mind on an object and you tell yourself, put it there, put it, just keep it there, keep it there. And then the vichara will go around and around that object, okay? And see this? Piti and sukha, rapture and bliss. It has also been translated as delight and happiness. Okay? Translated by someone very, very, very good Pali scholar. Piti translated as delight. Sukha translated as happiness. I think it's easier to understand, yes? Rapture, you're like, lotangki. So a bit difficult to understand. But delight. Delight is nice. Okay. Now, the word here, so to go into the first jhana, the set off point, the start off point has to be that there's no craving and there is no negativities. There is, you are detached from it. You let the negativities go. Don't hold on to them, you let it go. And born of that detachment, The mind focuses on the object. You lock it on the object. Very quickly, the mind will be happy. You'll be delighted and it will be happy. With the subsiding of vitakka and vichara, initial and sustained application, meaning the effort to keep putting the mind on the object, eventually the mind doesn't need you to put a lot of effort. It will stay there. Okay, it will stay with the object. And when it stays with the object, this capacity of the mind to talk, to think, will start to soften and it will start to go quiet. The word here is subsiding. You don't have to force it to stop. It will stop. It will fade away. With the subsiding of these mind thinking, talking, trying to fix something, the mind gains inner tranquility and oneness. Apart from the delight and the happiness, now it is peaceful. The mind is also peaceful. And oneness of mind, aware, clear, it's there. The mind is there staring at you, and you're very aware of that mind. This state is born of concentration. Because you were trying to let go of the thinking, you're trying to hold it, fix it on a single point, now it stays there. It stays at that point, more or less. And so in the second state, the second level, I would call it, in our Hokkien term, shiok lah. Because you got what? Happiness and joy and tranquility. These are all the expression that people are familiar with, yes? A lot of us get to this stage, only mai zao liao, quite happy. The fact that a lot of you don't meditate regularly means you never got there. Okay? If you had gotten here, I will put my money that you always go back to your meditation. The fact that you don't go back to your meditation, in fact, it becomes very addictive. It can become very addictive. Why do you think the Anagami couldn't finish their job? They got addicted to meditation. So they can let go of all the sensual delights, but they couldn't let go of the mental delight. This is a mental chewing gum. Very nice. It's very, very pleasant. Deeply, deeply, deeply satisfying. So, you might have gotten to the first stage. You might have. So your mind kind of stays still. And then you fell asleep in the first, around the first, right outside the first house, you fell asleep. Then when you woke up, you said, hey, time's up already, 20 minutes, well done. So you got up and then you happily wander off. So, and because of that, you never ever tasted the deep peace, the deep joy, the delight, that happiness that actually appear in the next house, only next door, okay? So in the second house is when you don't have to try very hard, the mind stays still on the object, and it is because of that concentration, the joy, the delight, the peace deepens. Very, very peaceful. Very, very happy. But all this delight will fade away. It fades away by itself. You don't have to do anything. After a while, you got tired of the delight. Actually, that's what the mind does. You know? It keeps staring at it, right? After a while, it got tired. And when it gets tired, it's not interested really. 假如说了, not interested. Then it drifts away. And the next one that you start to see, equanimity. Very detached. Very, very detached. very objective. This is a part where you don't make judgment anymore. You're detached. You don't make judgment. Good person, good thing, bad thing. No. You're just detached. And you begin to look at this word, aware, constant, thorough understanding of impermanence. And he experiences the bliss of which the noble ones say that bliss is experienced by one with equanimity and awareness. And with this, the third absorption. So the fading away of all those happy, delight thing, and then you end up very detached. It's very nice. It's very, just very detached. And very aware. You see, which part says they are asleep? Which part says snoring? Okay, noble people don't snore. So they don't snore. But still, which part says they are sleeping? Don't have, right? They're obviously very aware. Oh, aware. Constant, thorough understanding some more, okay? And it is like that. Even you can get to this state and you will then see, you literally see the arising and the cessation. And you see it come up and disappear, come up and disappear, and you are then detached about these changes. Okay? After the eradication of pleasure and pain, joy already passed away, joy and grief, you enter into a state beyond pleasure and pain, totally purified by equanimity and awareness. You know, you ask yourself, aya, no more joy. Like, I mean, detachment I can understand, but going beyond joy and pleasure and pain, what does that mean? Get there first, huh? You don't have to do anything, you don't have to will it. You just have to let it go. You let your attachment to the delight be. Remember, second stage was delight? You see delight so much. You eat and eat until you're very delight. You're filled, saturated with delight, okay? So familiar already. Then you let it go. You let it be. Let it be. You don't hold on to it. When you let it be, the mind will then drift on. And it drifts on to become detached. Upekkha, detached. Third stage is detached. Okay? But underpinning this detachment, right, there is still a pleasure. It's a very pleasurable experience. To get to the fourth, you have to let go of your attachment to the pleasure. You just let it go and move on. Okay? This flow is called right concentration. And you will notice someone already did happily say, eh? Constant, thorough understanding of impermanence, same as in sati leh. Exactly. This is when it converges. When you are doing this, you are using the mind to lock and track. And when your mind is locked and clear, it will track beautifully. It will see arising when it arises, it will see cessation when it ceases. So when it sees arising and cessation, because they are phenomenal of the mind, it continue to arise and fall away. Continue. Even in the state of that clarity that we kept talking about, the oneness of mind, ekagata, even in that state, there is arising and falling away. But except that, in that state, when it's arising and falling away, you're very clear, you see it. There are still sensations. You will still see it, and you see it very clearly. And you note it. Ah, this is how it fades away. Oh, now it's gone. Now it arises. These are the conditions it arose. Very clear. Not so many words, I'm talking to you, so it sounds like many words. But when you're actually meditating, it's not so many words. it will be spotted. I spotted something. But all the something and I all disappear. All you did is spot. No. Caught it. Okay? And when you catch it, you must understand what you just caught. You have to know what you just saw. Ah, anicca. Seeing anicca. Okay? And then once you know it, can you let it go? We come out of meditation, let it go, okay? The third one, samawayama, right effort. The purpose is to clean up your mental space, as the word says, so that the mind is fertile environment for spiritual practice. I will sum up this chart in this manner. This is not done deep in meditation. This is for your daily living, daily life. If you spend the whole day being a nasty person, you spend the whole day complaining, being so petty, being so difficult, water too hot, no, now it's too cold, ayah, why like that? Okay. At night when you meditate, the mind will give you hao kan. Fusion language, okay? Because the mind can't settle. You want this, you want that, cannot do this, cannot do that. The mind also like that at night. It's going to be very difficult. Remember, I said that if you have ill will, craving, the mind can't settle, okay? Cannot settle. So this right effort is to aid in meditation. The whole day you learn to do spring cleaning. Whole day you learn to spring clean. A negative thought, when a negative thought arises, put it out of the mind. You spot it, you put it out. Get rid of it. If there is no negativity and you know it, don't let it come up. So these practitioners, you know, they are very sharp. They can spot it, can see it. In the same way, if there are no positivity, meaning giving, loving, being wise, letting go. If there isn't such things in your mind, bring it up. And if they are there, proliferate these instincts, these thoughts. Okay, you do these things is to help you meditate at night. So for those of you who say that, hey, I'm a very nice person, no, I'm actually quite calm one. I'm quite calm. But the whole day you're very worried, ma. The whole day you worry about this, worry about that, worry about this, that. Then at night, how are you supposed to go from here to here? It will take you a while, lah. You can. But do you have 1 hour? Your 1 hour meditation, bring it down to about here. It's like, can start already. Then you fall asleep. Problem, right? You see the problem? Whereas if you spend the whole day being very mindful, being very aware, cleaning your mental space, letting go, don't care, like it's okay, doesn't really matter. Then at night when you sit, you don't have to start from here. Work so hard to bring it down to here. All you have to do is start from around here and you get started. Straight away, go into your breath, watch it. You can do sati, you can do samadhi, doesn't matter. You watch the breath, you track it, your mind goes into a state of quiet. Start to enjoy the pleasure. When you have the pleasure that arises, damn sure already, man, can chong. The mind will rise, okay? It's all very automatic. Think of it like an escalator. You know the escalator, right? The more high-tech one, you have it goes slow, but when you go in there, it will go fast by itself. This what power-saving escalator. This is very high-tech. Like that, like your mind is like that. You get it to a certain state, it will operate in a certain way by itself. You don't have to do anything to it. You don't have to persuade, please. It doesn't work like that. If you had been a very nasty character at night when you sleep, when you sit. It's a different S. S-I-T, sit, when you sit, you please, also it continue to make noise and be difficult. So this is why this one is important, okay? you need to have self-awareness, all of us. We have to have some degree of self-awareness, because many a times we don't realize that we are not nice people. Look, if you know you're not a nice person and you still continue being not nice, what does that say about you? Very not nice, right? You won't be here, one. You won't be in Buddhist fellowship practicing Dhamma like that. So chances are you're not very self-aware, that you don't realize that you are not being a nice person, you see. Many a times we don't realize it. And then sometimes, it's not that we don't realize, we can't stop ourselves. Because temper come out already. Don't want to scold. Problem. Also has lah. Huh? Also has. Okay, last bit. How do you develop wisdom? Oh, that's why I need my notes. It comes from the Book of Eight. And it was Buddha's advice to the monks on how they can develop wisdom. Oh, how clever. I didn't write this down. Okay, never mind. I will talk like that. If you look at this first one, it says a bhikkhu lives in dependence on a teacher towards whom he has a keen sense of moral shame or moral dread, affection, and reverence. So the very first way in which one develops wisdom, I've mentioned before earlier on, there are two sets of things, right? One is advice from an external source. The second one is correct attention. In case you forgot, it was from 2 weeks ago, I think, the notes. This one talks about external influence. You have a teacher with whom you have strong, good chemistry. It's because of your strong chemistry and you have a lot of respect for the person, then you will feel that you want to be doing the right thing so that that person will see you up, give you face, okay? So that person will look at you and say, not bad, you're doing well, give you and have respect for you. You want that. You see, a lot of us, with the person that we respect, we tend to be a bit more careful. More careful than with the person we love. Don't believe? Have you scolded your husband or wife? Ever. Have you scolded your bante? Never. Do you love your bante? No. And you love your husband and wife? Of course. What kind of a strange question is that? So I've always said, better to have respect than to be loved. If you have a lot of respect, no one will scold you. If you are loved, wait till his mood is bad. But better to have both love and respect. Both love and respect. Okay? So with a teacher that you have respect and love for, affection is love. Of course, you cannot put down that love, right? So affection. Then this is a good thing for you. Why is this so? You tend to be able to learn from somebody that you have good feelings towards and that you respect. It is very difficult to learn from someone you don't respect and you don't like. In fact, if you learn anything, it's I don't want to be like him. It's negative learning. Not so good, huh? This is Bante, right? This is learning from a spiritual teacher. Okay, so that's the first one. The second one says, from time to time, approach them and ask. Those venerable ones then disclose to him what has not been disclosed, clear up what is obscure, and dispel his perplexity about the numerous perplexing points. This assumes that you don't understand Dhamma and you have a lot of questions. There are many things you don't understand. That's why numerous perplexing points. so charm, so many questions. And you must be prepared to approach your bante, your teacher, your spiritual teacher, and ask. See, Buddha didn't start with, have a good teacher whom you like and respect. But you don't ask, what's the point? So it's the Wikipedia never use. Okay? You must go and ask them to tell you what you have never heard, what you don't understand. Ask him to explain. And the difference between clear up what is obscure and dispel perplexity, they are two different things, not the same. Clear what is obscure is, I have these words, I have this concept, I don't understand. Can you explain? The other one is, I have these words, I have these concepts, I know what they are saying, but I don't know their meaning. Dhamma is like that. Who doesn't know dukkha arya satya? Noble truth of dukkha, everybody in this room know. See, even when I say in Pali, you all knew. Who doesn't know samudaya dukkha arya satya? The arising, the noble truth of the arising of dukkha, everybody knows. But who doesn't, who knows nibbana, the third one, relief, nirodha dukkha arya satya, taste of relief, don't know. So you know the words, you memorize the words, but you don't know what it means. So clearing up what is obscure is when you don't know the words. You don't understand the meaning. Your perplexity is, I know the words. I sort of understand the meaning. But deep down, it doesn't hit. A lot of you read English, yes?
Yes.
And read well, yes?
Yes.
Just say yes lah. So we all read English, we read well, we all bought all those tick-tick books. No, they're all there, no, the tick-tick ones. The one that all ends with the word Nikaya, they're very thick, right? So we bought them and we read them and we're really so good, we even remember which suttas they came from. And then we don't realize. We just don't realize. Perplexity, lah. It's perplexity. So I know what's written there, I can read all the words, I have all the understanding. But I still don't get it. I don't get Dhamma. So you go approach the teacher to help clear up your perplexity. Now that you have heard Dhamma, you resort to two kinds of withdrawal. Withdrawal in body, withdrawal of mind. What does this mean? Kyutsui. Is it kyutsui? No. It means you start to practice. You start to practice. You have heard Dhamma. Now start looking at your mind and look at your body. Look inwards. The answers not found hanging on the wall. The answers are all stored within. So you look inwards for the answers. And you need to, these are all about practice. See that? The correct attention reading. Virtuous dwells restrained by the Patimokkha, seeing danger in minute faults. I really love this one. You see, a lot of us observe precepts, five precepts. Some of us may occasionally have gone for the eight precepts, seven, because you all kept saying we don't sleep on the floor. Okay, seven precepts, okay? And you come out of all these and you kept saying, I don't understand Dhamma, don't quite get it. It's okay. When you meditate and when you start to understand deeper, you begin to realize that every little thing that you do can have an impact on the mind. Every little thing. When there is the arising, just the arising of annoyance, you haven't even opened your mouth yet. Just the arising of annoyance, you already know. Or, sang tao le. The mind kena injured already. Got one stain there. And you become very aware of how the mind gets stained, gets touched Why are you so aware? Because in your meditation, it's very difficult. The moment you give in to anger, the moment you allow your mind to react very instinctively in a negative way, when you try and sit and meditate, it's tough. Already you know, sang tao le, tonight meditation got problem, let's do 2 hours. Okay? And the more you practice, the more you realize that even the arising, just a very subtle arising of craving, preferences, it's going to shake the mind. Just a little bit will shake the mind. So seeing danger in minute faults, it's the more sensitive you are about the nature of the mind, the more you realize that your decisions have consequences. This is karma. This is where you understand karma, pure and simple. Okay? Learn much, remember what he had learned, accumulates what he has learned. I urge you to remember this. You see, we learn, but sometimes we don't remember, lor. Then sometimes we learn, then we remember, but we don't keep it. This one says you learn. Okay, listen, they're not the same. They might sound the same, they're not the same. This one's learn, okay? This one you learn already, you remember. This one says build. You build on what you remembered. You cannot build on what you learn alone, because if you learn, you don't remember, cannot build. Looking for the missing brick, which is not there because you don't, where did I put it? I don't even remember what I read. Cannot use, okay? So you learn, you must remember, and then you can use what you remember to build. Okay? Then you go on to see. Learn much of, retain, recite. This is the part about learning. This is the part about proactively using. Mentally investigate. I just love the Buddha's brilliance, you know. If you go through a learning process of the Dhamma, you read exactly how it works in the mind. You listen, you remember, you use what you remember to build your understanding. Yes? As you use them to build your understanding, what does it mean? It means that on a daily basis, whether in meditation or in daily life, you are watching the world, watching your mind, interacting with the world. You reflect, you examine. You reflect and you examine Dhamma. And then one day you understand what they mean. This is understanding what it means. It's a process of learning. And then you want to, at this point, you are a very sharp meditator. You can see the mind as is. So when the mind has got negativity, you know, and you arouse virya energy for abandoning all those negativities and for developing all the wholesome ones. Buddha says, mental strength, try very hard. It is your duty, your responsibility. How true. Remember what I said? This life, I handle the negativity. Leave it to the next guy to handle the pleasant feelings. Here, Buddha says, you don't cast off your duty. Don't cast off your duty, meaning to say, you are the practitioner. Everything that you have to do, you have to do. It's what you want to achieve, okay? Now, we are a sangha of lay people. Sangha means community and order, okay? Of course, we are lay people. So this one, because he was talking to a monk, and therefore he said in the midst of Sangha. But as lay people, the same thing. If you are a practitioner, you don't want to constantly blabber, blabber, blabber. And Buddha recommends that you only talk Dhamma or get someone to talk Dhamma. And finally, this is wisdom, okay? You live reflecting on, thinking about, arising and the falling away of your five aggregates that are subject to craving, clinging. Such its form, such its origin, such its passing away, such as feeling, such as perception, mental formation. So form, feeling, consciousness, perception, mental formation. Five aggregates. What does it mean? Ultimately, in daily life, it is not about eating, eating, chewing, chewing, sleeping, sleeping. It is about when you look at your mind, can you see the arising and the falling away of feelings? How did it arise? How did it fade away? How did it not become a dukkha anymore? For each and everyone, feeling, form, physical form, thought formation, they all of these can give dukkha when you cling. And if you can see that thought is a clinging thought, you can see that because of the clinging underpinning the thought, you have sensation of dukkha, then you don't let go of the object, you let go of the clinging. This is what I've been saying. You want to tackle a dukkha, you don't tackle the object of dukkha, you tackle the clinging underpinning the object. You must be familiar with the clinging energy. And once you can see the clinging, and you can see the letting go of the clinging, any object is not a problem. Because you already settled the cause, the bottom line problem. Okay? The next one, spiritual transformation. Why is this thing still here? But never mind. Spiritual transformation, what is enlightenment and what happens, okay? That's next week. Question.
What's the Pali word for clinging?
Craving. Similar. I have to think about it. For the life of me, I can't. It doesn't spring into my mind. But when it springs in, I'll tell you. Yeah. Sure.
For the sati, right? Devoting the sati. Sometimes when you just note that the short breath, long breath, deep and shallow, right? You kind of like, when you do that, you are thinking about, is this a long breath, is it a short breath? So instead of noting it, but you are kind of like,
You know, I know what you're saying. Let me, this is the analyst approach. You don't have to get to that level of precision. If it feels like a short breath, it's a short breath. So just anyhow, short breath, long breath, short breath, it's like you are not a very good QC supervisor, you know? Okay, cannot, like that. So short breath, long, whether it's a short breath or a long breath, whether it's shallow or deep, actually really doesn't matter. What if it's medium? Does it fall into short or long, deep or not? Don't care. Today you are deep, tomorrow you are not. It actually really doesn't matter. What matters is the mind must get into this habit of spotting and making this objective observation. Objective, very objective. It's the objectivity you're training. It's not the clarity on the precision of breath that you are interested in. It's the objectivity you're training. So, is this red or orange? Don't care lah. Some say red, some say orange. I really don't care. But the point is, when you look at this, don't say blue. Because unless you're colorblind, but it's okay. But it's either red or orange. Or you can say gold or not. The point, as it is. Is this white or beige? White lah, beige lah, don't care. But objective. Training the mind to be very objective and being able to nail it as you see it, Because you need this habit. When you are watching in your meditation, when you're sitting deep in meditation and you're watching the mind, that habit of being able to describe something objectively, that skill must come out. Otherwise, how are you going to spot anicca? Rising, falling. You have to be able to spot that. So this skill that you develop to see things objectively, that same skill you're going to use to watch the mind as it unfolds before you, and then to call it. And honestly, when you see a phenomenon, it could be any of the three. It could be anicca, it could be anatta, it could be dukkha, it doesn't matter. The point when you spot it, what does it feel like to you? The point when you spot it is anicca. The point when you spot it is anicca. And this is how you see it. Anicca is like that, anicca is like that. It comes and it goes, it comes and it goes, it comes and it goes. Then one day, when you've been seeing this in your meditation for a while, suddenly you notice, actually, all these anicca moments sits on the previous condition. That's when you realize conditionality. It strikes you. This is what the Buddha has been saying about conditionality. Sound hits consciousness, there's contact. Contact gives rise to feelings. Condition. Then one other day, when you are sitting and you start to observe the same thing, they are still anicca, right? They are still conditionality, right? But that day when you clear today, that day your mind very good, never scold people, you're so nice, giving, you go home, sit very sharp. Then when you sit very quietly, you suddenly realize that all this conditionality shows you that there is an ecosystem going on with no driver, runs by itself. It's a machinery that runs by itself. There's no little man sitting inside there driving that little machinery, the big machinery. And then you suddenly saw anatta. Okay? So it's still anicca, it's still conditionality, there is still dukkha, but on this day you spotted anatta. That's all. So this habit of being able to see something and spot and call it, very important. It's a skill. It's a mental skill we're not used to, because our mind is more used to writing essay. Am I not so good at just giving one snap, quick answer? Cannot. Very difficult. Let me explain to you why can. And then it goes on. A lot of writing essays. We don't need that. We don't want that. And this is not finished. Spotting all these things is not the end of the answer. Spotting all these things is to get you to a point where the mind can let go by itself. You don't spot, you don't understand, no way you can let go. You can try, but you can't. When you say, I will let go, what inside? Worse than the mosquito that refuses to go away. Right? Letting go means it doesn't bother you anymore. How come your letting go got so many buzzing in the ears one? So obviously not done properly. So if you are at the stage of your practice where you actually haven't even sat for, an hour, haven't even hit first or second jhana, very difficult to see the mind. And if you haven't seen the mind, very difficult to talk about letting go. And when it's very difficult to talk about letting go, then the Dhamma is a big fuzzy puzzle. puzzle with 20,000 pieces, I only got two. You see what I'm saying? Give you an idea what it means, lah. Suppose that, say, you have done your meditation, you are very good at it, actually. You already begin to see things, but not quite consolidated. Then this 20,000 puzzle, you have possibly about 40%. 30-40%. If you have seen all the parts that he asked you to see, you've understood all the parts he asked you to understand, then you're up to about 70%. It's about like that, lah. But if you haven't even done a proper stint of meditation, and so you have never experienced a mind that's quiet and still, you've never seen how your feelings have faded away, taper off by themselves, you've never seen any of those things, you've got the wrong box! Your jigsaw puzzles are of another box! Don't even have the pieces. Oh, got two lah. We got Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. Right? Got Buddha and Sangha. You see what I'm saying? It's tough. But the moment you get your 40%, right? Actually, it's no longer 20,000 pieces. Once you get 40% of the pieces, the 20,000 piece puzzle is down to 100. Think of it like 100. You roughly know what's going on, and you roughly know how to do things. Okay?
What's your definition for practitioner? Oh, this is my first question. Second question is...
Buy one, get one free.
Am I right to say that all cravings are bad, except cravings for samadhi, dhamma, and all this? Is all cravings so bad? Yeah, this is my question.
Okay. Bad or good is a definition, is a personal definition. How do you define the term practitioner? Someone who is sincere about wanting to understand the Dhamma and realize Nibbana. I'm hardline one, conservative definition. Someone who is sincere about wanting to understand Dhamma and wanting to realize Nibbana, and you actually make it into a way of life, the Eightfold Path, make it, weave it into your way of life, then you're a practitioner. Okay? If you consider yourself to be, I'm interested in knowing Dhamma, but I think leave it to the next guy to figure out Nibbana, I will take a bit of the Eightfold Path, I don't want to do the Samadhi one, pick and choose, then you are not a practitioner. No such thing as a part-timer. You're not a practitioner. You are what I call a Dhamma curious seeker. Curious seeker. I'm very good at coining words, but not a real practitioner. A real practitioner must want to see Nibbana. Okay? And your second question, are all cravings bad? What is wanting to see Nibbana is wanting to experience unconditioned bliss, happiness. Happiness, unconditioned. To get to that state where you can experience a joy that comes only from within and not dependent on something from without, right? This state is possible only when the mind no longer has a rising of craving. It may be all the time, it may be temporarily. Moments when there is no craving, you're feeling very peaceful. Okay? And you know it, and you know how it is there, and you know why it is like that. Then you know Dhamma, you understand what's going on. And you want to continue like this. You want to continue not having a rising of craving. Because the only way your mind can enjoy this deep, unconditioned bliss and happiness is if, when there is no arising of craving, when craving doesn't come up. So you tell me, is craving good or bad by a practitioner's definition? By a practitioner's definition, craving is a problem. It is necessarily bad by a practitioner's definition. But if you are just okay lah, life is short what. Okay lah. So I don't crave for the drugs, I don't crave for taking advantage of people. I crave for doing good things. I crave for saving people. Someone drop into the sea, I will go save you, you know. Crave to do the right thing. Crave not to do the bad thing. That kind. Do good, do no evil, and you're just quite fixated about that. By the average person's definition, it's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing to want to do good, do no evil, right? Of course it is. It's not a bad thing. But if you crave, you really want to do the right thing and not do the evil thing, and then you get all obsessed and fixated about that, then it can also affect your practice. You may be too fixated about the trees and you miss the forest. So need to be mindful of that also. Craving ultimately is a problem. Craving will take you further away from Nibbana. Okay?
Your drive there to want to know Dhamma, want to meditate, you know, that's where the...
That's correct.
That's the craving there. So
yeah, it's that particular one is called Chanda.
So that this craving is good, right?
It's not...
If there's no drive there, then you never...
It is good only if you recognize it to be a craving. It is not good if you don't even recognize that you're craving and then you suffer for it.
So can I change craving to cultivate all these good things rather than craving?
Yeah. No. Craving is an energy and a state of mind. You cannot put on something and call it by a different name when it is obviously a craving. Craving means I want to see Dhamma, I want to see Dhamma, I want. That's one thing. Change it lah, one thing. Okay? It's still one thing. But if you recognize this as one thing, and you recognize that you really want Dhamma, at the very minimum of the series of one things that you have, this is the best. It's not good to have one thing because it actually affects your mind. But if you haven't even resolved it, right? You have all the one things, right? You have A to Z one things, right? Then this is the one that's good lah. You got a whole series of bad ones, but this one, okay. There's a whole series of bad ones that clog up your cholesterol, your blood vessels, and so on and so forth. But this particular this one's not so bad. It's what at least take you to someplace good. It makes you want to practice, makes you want to be spiritual, make sure that your karma doesn't go more. So it's a good one, okay? But ultimately, when it comes to the final stage, the Nibbana, you want to chong, you still got to let this go, which is why the Buddha kept saying, when you cross, you want to cross that stream, use the Dhamma, cross it, then leave it behind, move on. That's why it's like that, you see. Craving that took you across also must let go. Okay?
My question is also on craving. Two parts to this question. The first one is... So if the first step is to be detached and let go of the craving, just now, don't forget a quote, you said, you know, there was a quote about the first part of detachment, right? So if you're craving, how does one let it go? That's the first part of the question. The second part is, since we are still in this life now, it is nice to have craving and to be able to fulfill it. To give you an example, you feel really, really, really for eating chocolate, eat it up. Okay, so...
What's wrong with it?
Yeah, what's wrong with indulging a little in it, you know, instead of always being so, you know...
Uptight.
Not uptight, but as in if you want to attain Nibbana, we walk the path. But we are in this life now and we have yoga every day. These are a few of the simple delights of life, as long as it doesn't cause me or another person harm.
There's nothing wrong with these things. Okay. I forgot your first question, it was so long. not mindful enough. Craving.
Yeah. How do we manage it?
I said that unless you can see the nature of the mind as it is, your letting go is just jamming. It's actually very difficult. You can let go of anger in a very gross way. You can learn to moderate your expectations. You can learn to moderate demands. You can learn to say, it's okay, I don't mind. You can also learn to say, I don't want to fight you, I will just let it be. You can do that. These are all the gross form. And when you do these type of very gross type of letting go, it already makes you feel better. In a very small way, on a temporary basis, in your daily life, you don't want to fight, it makes you feel better. If you want to move on, and you can move on, it actually makes you feel better. To go in and fight, to go in and demand your rights, insist on things, sometimes can create more problem, create more pain. These are all very gross. But when it's down to the final point, whether or not the person can experience Nibbana, the complete unconditioned bliss, the joy that comes from within, the joy that doesn't depend on the external world, that one is tough. To get to that point, you need to be able to see the nature of the mind as it is. You have to be able to see that the mind has all these series of characteristics. So it is temporary, whatever that is experienced, it comes and it goes. And it is driving on its own rhythm, its own energy force. You have nothing to do with it. It just runs on its own steam. And if you can keep seeing it, you can see how feelings come, feelings go, how sensations come, sensations go, how thoughts will come, create a problem, and then it dissipates. When you start seeing this many, many times and seeing often enough, and you start to understand the Dhamma in a deeper way, then, only then, the mind starts to turn away from the instinct to crave. So this is a different level of letting go. I would even not call it letting go, I'll call it letting be, letting it be. What's the difference? The difference is to let go, you're dropping it, pushing it. I let you go, pushing it. Let be is do whatever you want. Seriously, do whatever you want. See that? So, which one takes less energy? Do whatever you wanna. Because letting go sometimes is another form of holding on. Some energy, some preferences. Okay? Not the same. So for yourself, you decide. Your call, your life, your choice. Whether you want to experience just the mundane delight using the Dhamma to give you some peace, in which case, don't quarrel with your partner lah. He has got a strange way of picking his nose, never mind lah. He eat louder than the camel, never mind lah. Let go. So, baking na chinchai lah. Shui pian lah. She has got a strange way of nagging at you, never mind lah. Your children don't want to study, don't know what's wrong with them, never mind lah. You learn to pick your fight. You learn to make priorities. The ones which are petty and small, you just let it be. The ones which are big and important to your life, then you say, hey, this one I got to put a stand. This one I think is important. Because if you do this, it's going to hurt a lot of people. I have to make a stand. Okay, you pick your fight. You choose your priorities. You know not to kill yourself with too many demands. Too many expectations. That's for the lay life, mundane life. For those of you who are saying that, I want to see the Dhamma, I really want to see the Dhamma. I'm not talking about just living a mundane life. Then you're going for the higher order thing. And going for the higher order thing is the Eightfold Path, all in its full glory, with into your life. Live according to the path. Spend your time watching how the mind works. Know exactly how the mind works. Because if you don't know how it works, there is no way you can know how to reverse the damage that is already done, that has already been done to the mind. You don't know how to reverse it. You don't know how to make the mind unshakable. Tomorrow, someone close to you passed away, a lot of us are going to be very affected. It's very rare. But when you start to be able to see the mind properly and deal with the conditions of the mind correctly, then you'll find that there are a lot of things in life can deal with one. You know how to deal with it. Okay? Okay, that was question one. What's question two? Okay. I think I answered that more or less already. If you are living just a lay life, enjoying yourself, Buddha didn't tell you must let everything go. Buddha just gave you the suttas that will help you live a meaningful lay life. Keep it balanced. Give some time to being the nice, good person, be responsible lay person. You can continue to enjoy your little delights. This is your choice. You want to live in a lay life? It's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. He even told them how to do it right. And then you must put some time in for a spiritual development. Cannot only just indulge, give some time for spiritual development. Why is that? Because whatever life you're living, I give you 120 years, you would go into Guinness World of Record already, but you're still dead. At the end of 120 years, you're still dead. And then you will start somewhere. There will be a reset button and then it starts somewhere again. Right? Boot. New one, okay? Then what happened? Have you done anything to make sure that one is okay? No, you're sorry. Too petit. But not I, right? Not I. Cannot lah. Must do the right thing. Be responsible, you know, for people. Just do the right thing. And make sure that you leave the place, when you leave this world, a better place than when you found it. Okay?
Why is the statement seeing the body used instead of just saying that seeing the body?
Seeing the body in the body. You know, when you're looking in the form, I think there are different ways of looking when the mind can see. The mind can just see a form, or the mind can go investigate a little deeper and be more aware of this is just a form, but in the form, you are developing a deeper understanding of the form. Developing a deeper seeing of the form.
The changing nature of the form.
Mm. Not just the form, but in this form, within this form, there are things to be watching closely. It's an emphasis. In this form, within this form, there are things you should be looking at. And this is how you should look at it. Just look at the form. To me, it sounds a little more... the lack of emphasis does not... provide... In my mind, when you just say, look at the body, doesn't feel quite correct. Look at the body, in this body. Within this form and in this form, I want you to look at these things. Look at the body, it's a distant, it's just outside. You're not studying closely, you're not investigating closely. I think that's what it means.
Can I say it's a reflection?
No. No, such psychic capabilities. No. It's a very straightforward. Think of it like grammar, English. Look at a form. Look within this form. What does it tell you? It's a double emphasis. Okay?
Can we say it's a changing phenomenon in the body?
Which comes later. You are to look at this and look at it properly, in other words. Looking at this and look at it properly. Okay? And as you look at it very closely, the real nature, the phenomenal will appear, will become evident to you. Actually not appear, they're all there, but it becomes evident to you. If you look at it superficially, they are not obvious. But if you look at it deeply, it becomes obvious. Okay?